Link TV, connecting you to the world. Link TV is viewer supported. Watch more at linktv.org.
Link TV presents Mosaic World News from the Middle East. Here are today's top stories.
Military Council approves political isolation law as deadly Cairo clashes enter a third day. Bahrain admits to using excessive force against protesters. And Syrian troops attack Turkish buses. Mosaic World News from the Middle East begins now.
أهلا بكم. ضمن أبرز تطورات الوضع في مصر، أصدر المجلس العسكري الأعلى مرسوما بما يعرف بقانون إفساد الحياة.
In one of the most prominent developments in Egypt, the Supreme Military Council issued a decree banning those who corrupted political life from participating in politics. In this context, revolutionary parties in Egypt demanded to sack the Prime Minister Essam Sharaf's government and form a government of national salvation amidst continuous protests and violent confrontations between protesters and security forces in Tahrir Square, which have killed 33 people. On the other hand, revolutionary parties called for a million-man march tomorrow under the slogan, Million People March for National Salvation. Meanwhile, Egypt's public prosecutor released 64 people who were arrested during clashes. As mentioned earlier, Egyptian medical sources said 33 people were killed in the clashes in Tahrir Square in downtown Cairo and several other provinces, which began last Friday between protesters and security forces. For his part, the assistant commander of the Central Military Zone, Major General Saeed Abbas, reiterated in a press conference the Military Council's commitment to the political roadmap leading to a power transfer and an elected civil government.
Tahrir Square in Cairo is living a new day of chaos.
تجددت المواجهات بين المتظاهرين وقوات الجيش والشرطة لليوم الثالث.
Confrontations were renewed between protesters and the army and police forces for a third consecutive day. The square appeared to be a rest of war zone, and its effects extended to surrounding buildings. The protesters blamed the Interior Ministry after a number of casualties occurred. The protesters' demands seem to be clear this time.
We demand the immediate resignation of Essam Sharaf's government and the swift and fair trials of everyone who has Egyptian blood on their hands or incited bloodshed. We demand Interior Minister Mansour al-Assawi, the Director of the General Security, and the Director of the National Security be held legally accountable, as well as anyone who is directly or indirectly involved in causing the bloodshed of Egyptians.
Resentment for the Military Council appeared to be the common factor that angered the protesters.
The youth of the revolution alone are facing security forces, confronting tear gas, rubber bullets, and live bullets. Therefore, we hold the Military Council responsible for the revolutionary martyrs' death and the situation, which has intensified immensely.
In turn, the Military Council held a brief press conference affirming its commitment to the transfer of power to an elected civilian administration.
The next step is to fully implement the political roadmap laid out by the Supreme Council for the Armed Forces with all of its details, and the results should be announced by an appropriate institution, be it an elected parliament, Shura Council, or a committee to oversee the constitutional process.
So, even if the protesters and the Military Council restore their trust, it appears that the situation in Egypt still faces many possibilities.
And now to Bahrain, where authorities have conceded the use of excessive force against anti-regime protesters. This after international rights groups and activists lashed out at Manama for an iron-fisted response to protests. Now, the government also admitted in a statement that detainees have been mistreated. The statement comes 2 days ahead of a report by an inquiry panel commissioned by King Hamad to probe misconduct during the crackdown between February and March. Anti-regime protests have been raging in Bahrain for months. Protesters have been taking to the streets despite the bloody crackdown. Saudi-backed forces have killed dozens of protesters and have arrested hundreds of others. Now, the ruling Al Khalifa regime was founded with British backing in 1820. And now to Saudi Arabia, where thousands of protesters have taken to the streets condemning the government's killing of a teenage boy. Saudis in the oil-rich eastern province are mourning the death of 19-year-old Nasser al-Mahishi, who was killed on Sunday night by regime forces while walking along with a group of friends in the town of Khatif. Security forces have injured and arrested dozens of people in the past few days. Now, tensions have been high after Riyadh decided to escalate its troop presence. The government called in the troops late last month after protesters took to the streets for several days, calling for more freedom and the release of prisoners. In the absolute monarchy, protests and political gatherings of any kind are prohibited. Well, the U.S. Central Intelligence Agency has faced a debacle in Lebanon. Hezbollah has burst several U.S. spy rings, arresting a number of American spies. Hezbollah leader Said Hassan Nasrallah said in a televised address back in June that his movement had identified and captured at least two CIA spies who had infiltrated its ranks. In recent months, CIA officials have been secretly trying to protect their remaining spies in Lebanon before Hezbollah could find them. Tel Aviv also has not fared any better in the espionage matters. Dozens of Israeli spies were arrested by Hezbollah back in June. Well, the CIA's operations in Lebanon have been badly damaged after that busted spy ring. We're going to switch over to Beirut, where we're joined by Ali Riz. Thanks so much for being with us, Ali. What's the latest that you have on this situation?
Well, until now, Hezbollah has not made a comment, nor have we heard any comments from Lebanese officials. There will be a meeting for Hezbollah's political bureau, a routine meeting tomorrow. I'm not sure after that if any statement will be released. It might be possible that a statement will be released. However, regarding this whole issue, there are four points, I think, which are worth mentioning. First of all, I think it points out to Hezbollah's formidable capabilities, technically wise, intelligence wise. Of course, Hezbollah is known for its military capabilities, and now I think with this latest piece of news we can add to that the great intelligence capabilities, because this is not the Mossad we're talking about anymore. We're talking about CIA, which is known to be the most qualified intelligence agency in the world. In fact, some CIA or some American officials have saying, for example, that we have one official saying that Hezbollah is a formidable intelligence, mighty military and accomplished intelligence organization. Another official saying it's the most technically capable terrorist movement in between brackets in the world. So that's one point. The second point is that it shows that America or the West is resorting to espionage tactics, maybe instead of the direct military warfare, because military warfare has proven to be a failure. We saw that happen in Iraq and Afghanistan. So they've resorted maybe to intelligence, which could lead to assassinations. And if you also, we have to note here that the most important officials in America, defense officials like Robert Gates, he was a former CIA member. Leon Panetta, the current defense secretary, was the former CIA chief. So I think it shows that the U.S. is shifting its military warfare more to espionage, with the aim in the end of maybe assassination. So it all comes within the context, I think, of soft war instead of all-out military warfare, showing a shift maybe in the way the U.S. is trying to confront its enemies.
In the latest developments of the Syrian revolution, the death toll has risen to 18. The Syrian local coordination committees said that 14 people were killed in Homs, three in Amma's countryside, and one in Rika by the gunfire of Assad's brigades. In conjunction, the Syrian opposition organized demonstrations on a Tuesday dubbed the Day of Freedom for Yaman al-Qadiri, who has been detained by the regime since November 3rd. Meanwhile, the Turkish Foreign Ministry announced that two of its citizens were wounded in an attack on a bus carrying Turkish visitors in Syria.
مشهد الدم بات ملازما للحياة اليومية في المدن والبلدات السورية.
The bloody scene has become part of daily life across Syrian cities and towns, which have been witnessing anti-regime demonstrations for over 8 months. The local coordination committees announced that various neighborhoods in the city of Homs are witnessing random raids and acts of violence by security forces. The committees added that several people were killed in Homs and several others were killed in the town of Karnaz near Hamma. They further said that military operations are being carried out in the areas of Idlib, Dera, Hasaka, Hamma, and other regions.
في عدد من المدن والبلدات السورية للمطالبة بإسقاط النظام.
Demonstrations erupted across various Syrian cities and towns demanding the downfall of the regime and the departure of President Bashar al-Assad. The Syrian opposition organized demonstrations on a Tuesday dubbed the Day of Freedom for Yaman al-Qadiri, who has been detained by the regime since November 3rd. The strained relationship between Syria and Turkey has taken a turn for the worse following a security breach that dominated the unfolding events in Syria.
أن جنودا سوريين فتحوا النار عند نقطة تفتيش على الحدود السورية.
Turkish media sources reported that Syrian troops opened fire at a Turkish bus carrying Turkish visitors near a checkpoint along the Syrian border in the north, inflicting casualties among the passengers. The passengers said that 8 Syrian troops intercepted the convoy and ordered them off the bus near a checkpoint before indiscriminately opening fire at them.
كانوا مختبئين في مخابئهم.
They were hiding. They were soldiers and not civilians. One of the troops told me, "Come over. Come over." He wanted me to get closer, but I refused. He pointed his gun at me and ordered me to raise my hands. I yelled for everyone to run away, and we all ran away. Then they started firing at our backs. God save us.
وكانت المواقع الإلكترونية التابعة للمعارضة السورية قد تداولت صور.
Opposition websites released footage of the damaged buses near the Bab al-Hawa border crossing, adding that the incident triggered a Turkish security alert at the border.
شددت المملكة العربية السعودية على ضرورة توفير.
Saudi Arabia stressed the importance of providing protection to Syrian civilians and ending all acts of killing and violence. Following its weekly session presided by Crown Prince Naif bin Abdel Aziz, the Saudi Council of Ministers called on the Syrian government to fully implement its pledges towards the Arab Action Plan to resolve the crisis in Syria. The council also hailed the efforts by the Arab League regarding the situation in Syria.
Turkish Prime Minister Recep Tayyip Erdogan said that Syrian President Bashar al-Assad's days in power are numbered. Meanwhile, the Russian Foreign Minister accused the West of adopting a, quote, provocative behavior in the Syrian crisis.
Massive protests erupted in the streets of the Yemeni capital, Sana'a, condemning the air and artillery shelling of the city of Arhab by forces loyal to Yemeni President Ali Abdullah Saleh. Thousands of protesters took to the streets of Ibb in central Yemen to protest the massacres committed by Saleh's regime against the residents of Taiz and Arhab. The protesters renewed their rejection of the Gulf Cooperation Council's initiative and demanded that no immunity be granted to the killers whom the initiative is trying to protect. The protesters marched through city streets following a speech rally in which a statement was read condemning the murder and attacks of women during demonstrations in Taiz and Sana'a.
وقال أفراد قبائل يمنيون معارضون للرئيس اليمني علي عبد الله صالح أنهم اقتحموا قاعدة عسكرية شمال صنعاء تستخدمها قوات.
In northern Sana'a, tribesmen opposing Yemeni President Ali Abdullah Saleh announced they stormed a pro-Saleh military base and seized weapons. Tribal commander Hamid Asim, who clashed with Republican forces led by Saleh's son, said 7 tribal fighters and several troops were killed in the attack. Saudi Arabia is seeking to end the Yemeni revolution through a tribal solution between Al-Ahmar and Salish tribes, away from the political scene and without achieving the people's demands for reforms. This news comes after the UN Security Council postponed its session on Yemen to allow Riyadh to push ahead in that direction.
The UN Security Council has adjourned its session on Yemen for a week, as demanded by Yemeni President Ali Abdullah Saleh. It's a new deadline issued under the pretext of, quote, searching for a political solution to ensure a peaceful transfer of power. This delay comes amid international news reports in what was attributed to a Western diplomatic source, saying that Western mediators are considering the possibility of brokering direct talks between the Yemeni president and his two rivals, General Ali Mohsen al-Ahmar and Sheikh Hamid al-Ahmar. The deal aims to activate all guarantees stipulated by the initiative, including those that were not included in the UN Security Council's resolution. In what was leaked to media sources, it seems that Saudi Arabia is leading the mediation efforts. Riyadh is trying to broker a deal for smooth transition of power from President Saleh to a key figure in the al-Ahmar tribe, most likely Sheikh Hamid al-Ahmar. It's a tribal solution removed from the political scene, which could undermine the demands of the Yemeni revolution for freedom, democracy, and reforms. Observers believe that any partial solution in Yemen will not succeed, especially amid the escalating revolutionary resolve and the protesters' commitment to achieving all their demands.
The Jordanian monarch, King Abdullah II, ended his visit to Ramallah, where he met with Palestinian President Mahmoud Abbas. During his visit, which was scheduled at the last minute, the Jordanian king discussed the latest political developments with the Palestinians, especially the issue of reconciliation. More details in our correspondent Aman Irakat's report from Ramallah.
بطائرته المروحية العسكرية حط العاهل الأردني الملك عبد الله الثاني.
Jordanian King Abdullah II descended from his military helicopter in front of the Palestinian presidential headquarters in Ramallah. Palestinian President Mahmoud Abbas described the king's first visit since 2000 as a great visit which will always be remembered. The Jordanian king wanted to discuss an array of issues during a phase described as sensitive. These issues included Jordan's full support for the Palestinian bid at the UN Security Council to receive full membership for a Palestinian state, the importance of achieving a united internal Palestinian front, and Jordan's rejection to the talks of an alternative homeland.
To anyone who says we call for an alternative homeland or earmark an alternative homeland or any similar talks, we say that the Jordanian king's position is very clear. The independent Palestinian state can only be established in the Palestinian territories with East Jerusalem as its capital. This is Jordan's position. Anyone who says otherwise has no ground for it.
We will not accept the idea that Palestine has an alternative. Palestine is the nation for Palestinians. Jordan is the nation for Jordanians.
The Jordanian monarch's visit brought forth many questions about the Jordan's proposals for the Palestinian leadership, especially since the visit takes place merely days before the anticipated meeting between the Palestinian president and Hamas's political bureau chief, Khalid Mishal, in Cairo.
The purpose of the meeting is to affirm Jordan's continuous mediation on the highest level in order to face the current challenges, especially as countries in the region are going through political changes. In addition, it is a positive move connected to the Arab Spring.
Jordan's affirmation of its position supporting the two-state solution based on the June 4, 1967 borders came with the Palestinian assertion that it is ready to return to negotiations as soon as Israel stops all settlement activities and recognizes these borders as those of the independent Palestinian state. While some consider the Jordanian king's surprise visit as historical, others say its timing is imperative as it coincides with Palestinians' anticipation for the future of both their internal and external statuses. From Ramallah City, Iman Arigat, BBC.
Iran decided to boycott today's meeting of the International Atomic Energy Agency amid growing tensions over the West and its nuclear ambitions. The Iranian envoy to the UN nuclear watchdog declared that the move was his country's first response to the IAEA's bombshell report exposing Iran's rogue nuclear program. Ali Asghar Soltania said Iran also decided to stay away from the discussions due to Israel's participation. As speculation rises about a possible Israeli strike on Iran, the country's Revolutionary Guard has dared Israel to attack. A senior Guard official said today that such an action by Israel would elicit a response that would end the Jewish state. Back here at home, medical residents gradually returned to work today after last week's mass resignations. Heeding high court orders, the young physicians have agreed to another round of negotiations with the Treasury. The high court appointed former Supreme Court Justice Professor Yitzhak Zamir and President of the Israel Association of Mediators, Moti Mironi, to help expedite the process. Initially, the Treasury objected to Mironi's appointment, saying the second mediator should be someone in the medical field. But later, the proposal was accepted after Supreme Court President Dorit Beinish accused the finance ministry of trying to undermine the negotiations. The parties are required to inform the Supreme Court of their progress in 2 weeks' time. In the meantime, hospitals across the country are operating as usual.
New York City officials have arrested a U.S. citizen on charges of building a pipe bomb to use against American troops. 27-year-old Jose Pimentel had been under close surveillance since May of 2009 for his apparent ties to the now-deceased al-Qaeda cleric Anwar al-Awlaki. The New York City Police Commissioner said that the killing of al-Awlaki in a U.S. drone attack spurred Pimentel's desire to harm U.S. forces returning home from Iraq and Afghanistan. Officials believe Pimentel was acting alone and was not a part of a greater conspiracy. He has been charged with 3 counts of terrorism-related activity and 2 other offenses.
نتواصل معكم من تلفزيون فلسطين، ولكن الآن في الشأن الإسرائيلي، حيث أكدت الباحثة الإسرائيلية نوريت الحنان.
Israeli researcher Nurit El-Hanan asserted that Israeli textbooks cultivate apartheid, and the Israeli education institution aims to prepare the Israeli youth to justify the Israeli army's crimes. Anas Buarku reports.
Israeli researcher and professor of language and education at Hebrew University, Professor Nurit Peled El-Hanan, concluded that Israeli textbooks cultivate racist apartheid against Arabs and Palestinians and encourages treating them like a demographic problem. Hebrew newspaper Ma'ariv said that Elkanan's conclusions can be found in her new book, which will soon be published in English. In the book, she says the Israeli apartheid is not only a group of racist laws, but an ideology towards Arabs and Palestinians. Elkanan worked on her book from 1996 to 2009. It is called Palestine in Israeli Schoolbooks, Ideology and Propaganda in Education. She believes that the purpose of the Israeli Education Institution is to prepare the Israeli youth to justify the Israeli army's crimes by simplifying complicated Israeli-Palestinian conflicts. The city of Misrata, which became famous during the Libyan Revolution as a stronghold for the revolutionaries against the late Colonel Muammar al-Gaddafi's battalions, is hosting an exhibition of the variety of weapons seized during the fighting against Gaddafi's forces. One of the most prominent items exhibited is the golden fist that used to decorate Gaddafi's headquarters in the Bab al-Azizia complex.
The city of Misrata became famous in the recent Libyan war as a stronghold for revolutionaries against the late Colonel Muammar al-Gaddafi's battalions and is now a symbol of the revolution. The city suffered a suffocating siege by the battalions for 5 months. On Tripoli Street, an open-air museum showcases a collection of tanks, mortar shells, and Molotov cocktails seized during the fierce fighting against Gaddafi's forces.
It's a very nice feeling. We came to Misrata to see it. All this destruction and the war crimes. May God prevent this from ever happening again.
معروضات المتحف جمعت من ميادين القتال.
The items were collected from the battlefields where the Gaddafi battalions were defeated. The most prominent item is the giant statue of the Golden Fist holding an American warplane. They used to decorate Gaddafi's headquarters in Bab al-Azizia. It used to represent Gaddafi's hostility towards the West. This statue is now here, covered in the revolutionary slogans and the colors of the new Libyan flag.
متزينا بالشعارات الثورية وألوان العلم الجديد. النسر المعدني الضخم الذي
The large metal eagle that also used to be in Gaddafi's home inside the Bab al-Azizia compound is on display in the museum. The eagle has a 4-meter wingspan and clutches a life-size mannequin of Gaddafi in its claws.
للقذافي
نطلق على هذه اليد كما كانت تسمى يد تحطيم العدوان الغاشم الآن
This hand used to be called the hand to smash the tyrannical enemy. Now we say it's the hand of the resistant Misrata. Misrata is the iron fist that crushed the tyrant and his aides in this war.
الكثير من الأسر التي كان بعضها يصطحب أطفالا صغارا طافت بأجنحة المتحف لكن ما يثير قلق الكثيرين
Many family with young children toured all parts of the museum. But what concerns many is the spread of weapons in Libya and its negative impact on the democratic transition process and internal security challenges that may extend beyond the border. Ibrahim Hasnawi, Russia Today.
The views expressed on Mosaic are from contributing broadcasters, not Link TV or its sponsors. The production of Mosaic is made possible by grants from the John D. and Catherine T. MacArthur Foundation, the Wincote Foundation, the Firedoll Foundation, and by support of viewers like you. Thank you. Watch Mosaic World News online. Stay up to date with breaking news, read our blog, get transcripts of past shows and more at linktv.org/mosaic. This program is brought to you by Link TV for educational and non-commercial use only. Link TV is the only U.S. network dedicated to global and national news, uncompromising documentaries, and diverse cultural programs, programs which connect you to the world.